Hello, I'm Pakeisha Kumbo, and we're going to tell you a story about the blues. It's not the complete story, but we will take you from the turn of the century to contemporary times. We're going to be tracking the blues, and we call this Bluesville. Hello, welcome to a continuation of the Jimi Hendrix special. I'm Pakeisha Kumbo, and we are here at 1600 Broadway at the Concrete Studios with two of Jimmy's best friends, Tahaka Aleem and Tundera Aleem. We're going to be talking about all the life that revolved around them and Jimi Hendrix. So let's get it on, brothers. How did you come to know Jimi Hendrix?
I'll let you answer that today.
Well, we got to know Jimi. We sort of lived together. Yeah. I say sort of lived together because, Jimi used to come in and out. Well, we had the same girlfriend. What happened was there was a young lady who later on became my wife. Her name is, got me a little confused. We can edit this and all of
his wife. He forgot his wife's name.
Well, my wife's name. June Vasquez. Well, what happened was a mutual friend of Jimmy's and mine, Faye Pridgeon. Faye had a friend named June, who later on became my wife, who was a girlfriend of Jimmy's. And somehow when I came in the picture, I think it sort of moved Jimi out of the picture with her. We sort of fell in love. And but Jimi was still staying at the house at the time.
Where were you staying?
We were living in the Park West Village. Uptown. In Harlem, right on the outskirts, and somehow when she and I got together, she was looking forward to me, you know, sort of like putting Jimi out or something. I guess that's what her intentions was. You know, I think if sometime now I'm a little clear on the situation. It was almost like she was using me to get rid of him, and I guess she was probably trying to find someone else to get rid of me. It looked like a cycle, you know. But anyway,
revolving door,
right?
And your wife now?
No, fortunately,
she got off and took
she,
the escalator.
She took the escalator.
She's going revolving,
right? So what happened was, so this was my first opportunity. I had the chance to meet Jimi. Of course, he wasn't the Jimi Hendrix that we all know now. He was a studying musician, and the beauty of the whole thing is she was wondering why I would allow this guy to stay in the house. I guess she beginning to think maybe there was something going on with me and him or something, you know. But the real deal was I used to see this guy coming in every day with records, different records, and this guitar, you know. And it sort of fascinated me because I had a little music background. I have musical background in my family, but I've never really seen a serious, studying, professional musician. And I noticed that his whole life was about music. You know, he used to bring these old blues records in, you know, like Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, I mean, all these great old blues records that when I was a kid I used to hear and say, hey, that's wino music. But it wasn't wino music because this guy was totally into it and he was studying all these licks, you know. But meanwhile, she was pressuring me about getting rid of this guy. But I was fascinated with this guy, you know, studying this music the way he was studying it.
Well, studying at that time, if I may add, you know, studying. Because, of course, again, like my brother said, we were involved in music and always was involved in music.
I think that we did have a knowledge of what study was because of my sister, who was a pianist, right? My brother and I would always take my sister to music classes, and so we really had a knowledge of what intense study represented. But then we moved off into our level of music study, which was singing and, you know, hanging out in the hallways and doo-wopping, like, you know,
drinking a little wine.
But Jimmy was almost a studying bum, you know, to a degree. You know, like you find people who stay in college and just really study, you know, and they're even afraid to get out.
But Jimmy didn't care yeah. where he lived. He didn't care anything. His concentration was almost as though he was on a mission.
Right. Didn't care.
And of course, this fascinated me. So it was no way in the world that I was going to tell a guy like this, because I was fascinated over what he was doing and how intense his study was. So I wasn't about to say, get off. You know, I was about to tell her to get out.
Roots, Jimi Hendrix was a blues man at heart, obviously. And we're going to kick a tune, a classic blues that he wrote called Red Heart. Red House.
Jimi Hendrix was greatly influenced by the country blues. T-Bone, Muddy Waters, Smokey Hog, and others. He truly was a blues musician. Here's the artwork of Martin Dixon, photographer, and it seems as though these pictures were made for this music.
Oh yeah, everything gonna be all right this morning. Now when I was a young boy at the age of five. My mother found a bee, the greatest man alive. But now I'm a man, I made 21. I want you to believe me, honey, we're having lots of fun. I'm a man,
yeah!
I spell him H-I-N, that rather than main,
yeah!
No B, oh child. I spell managed boy, a man, I'm a full grown man, I'm a man, I'm a rolling stone, I'm a man, I'm a hoochie coochie man, sitting on the outside, just me and I made.
By the 1960s, the electric lead guitar style of T-Bone and B.B. King had been fused with the Chicago small combo sounds of Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters. Muddy says, I was disc jockeying in Chicago on WOPA under Big Bill Hill. He was a good blues man too. And I was playing strictly blues. Sometimes a cat would call and say, hey, why don't you play some music, man? Get off them blues. How about some jazz? And I'd say, all you have to do is just turn your radio dial a little bit and you can miss me. Many urban blues bands have followed this format, fusing electronic lead guitar with the small combo sounds ever since. I should've said no.